بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Let's go to God. So we are now at we finished the first address to Bani Israel that they should not mix truth with falsehood and should join the believer in their prayers, etc. إلى آخره.
Yeah. So believe in my revelation coming, the confirming the revelations you already have. Do not be the first to deny it, and do not barter away my verses for trivial gain, but be mindful of me.
Yeah, and we did the one after that. ولا تلبسوا الحق بالباطل. Don't confuse truth and falsehood. And then the one after, join those who pray and bring zakah and perform ruku' with the raki'in. In the numbering, yes, it's number 40. So the next ayah is number, I think, in your numbering is 44.
Yeah.
So, in Duri is 43. Okay, so read it. تأمرون الناس بالبر وتنسون أنفسكم وأنتم تتلون الكتاب أفلا تعقلون.
As you read the book, do you command others to be virtuous and yet forget yourselves? Don't you comprehend? So he's translating the word forget. Is it forget or is it neglect?
Read another translation. Let's read the literal one, see if the literal one is more persuasive.
One second. Let me go to Quran.com then for that one.
Yeah. And have it open right away from the beginning. So
no, of course, because I got the other one. So you got two. Quran.com has a word-by-word translation on it.
Oh, and also this what is it? Islamawakened.com is also having...
That's the one I'm reading from right now.
But there's
three translations on Islam Awakened. Do you bid other to be pious the while you forget your own selves and yet recite the divine writ? Will you not then use your reason?
Yeah. This is the allegedly the literal one, yeah?
I don't know. It's just Muhammad Asad, isn't it?
Muhammad Asad. No, there's a called in the top or in the bottom. I think earlier it was usually in the top.
Yes. Maybe they have it. So that was Muhammad Asad.
The literal translation. Let us see what's the literal one.
So this is Muhammad Asad, right at the top. Do you bid other people to be pious the while you forget your own selves, and yet you recite the divine writ? Will you not then use your reason?
Yeah. So this is here. It says ta'murun. He said you bid, or you could command. The word amara is the most. Or advice, because amara in Arabic language, I think we discussed that casually, but we may go to maybe the first time we faced the root amara, from which the word amir, which means commander.
I think we covered that in the amadi, in terms of nature of amara.
No, I mean in the tafsir of Quran. We don't want to refer the people to amdi. That's the first time you come to amara. Amara in Arabic could be meaning commanding, but could be advice. So do you advise or command the people to do righteous or to be righteous or to perform righteous and pure acts, and you forget yourself, or tansawna anfusakum, or neglect yourself? But the word nasiya in Arabic could have two meanings. One is the usual forgetting, the standard one, which something is slipped out of your mind, is not present in your mind. And another use of it is forsake something as if it has been forgotten, but really not forgotten, but you decided to leave it out and neglected. And that's when something like nasiya is attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah is impossibly can be forgetting. So what is it? He has forsaken or neglected. Like we said, nasu Allah fa ansahum anfusahum. They forgot Allah. You'll forget you today as you have forgotten. The second forgotten is really forgotten. The people forgotten, or shows just to ignore the until if it is not present in their mind. Like many people, most people now, if you go anywhere in London, like you meet hundreds of people, you say, what do you think about the divjal? You say, what's the divjal? What's it? It's like in a state of shock. It doesn't come in his mind, because most likely he's mostly, I know mostly, but even many Muslims, so nominal Muslims, he did not start the day with Salah. So in the Salah, when we say, ask Allah protection from the hellfire and so on, that's Liyom al-Akhir, that's Akhirah. So he's reminded, at least Akhirah, and every Salah he's reminded, even just for a few seconds. But for usual kafir, Akhirah is never mentioned. And death is avoided to mention, because death, mentioning death is very nice and very, usually very, very disturbing and counterproductive for your activity, etc. So he has completely, although he knows, he did not forget that the people and the prophets have claimed there's something called Akhirah. Actually, he has just ignored it until it slips his mind. Anyway, those who denied Akhirah and forgot about it completely, Allah said, Al-yawma nansakum, today we will forget you, meaning we will forsake you, we'll just ignore your existence, we'll just leave you in the hell. كَمَا نَسِيْتُمْ لِقَاءَ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. We forget it. So the attribute to Allah, it cannot be the forgetting in the Prophet, meaning just ignore, neglect, forsake. So you command or advise people to be righteous, but you neglect or you forget yourself. While وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُوا الْكِتَابِ سَأُولِكَ while at the same time, this state of affair is not for something ignorant about divine commandment and the books. These people of the book who shall address with that, especially here specifically, the Jews of Medina, because in Medina they were barely any Christian. There may be a scattered few Christian, but the address, the opening chapter or section was Yabani Israel, children of Israel. So we're talking about the Jews, either by genealogy, children of Israel, or by belief, those who Judaized, became Jews. So while you are reading the writs, the books, the scripture, writ is good, scripture is good, whatever translation, maybe scripture will be better because that's the standard word used in English for the ancient books, for the old and New Testament. So while you are reciting, and the Quran is very accurate, reciting this way, they are not reading it. Reading in Arabic entails studying and more understanding than just mere reciting. While you are reciting the scripture, but even the mere reciting of the scripture should put you in a state of affair that you should not be only commanding people to do righteous. Yeah, you should do, but you should also not forget yourself. You should start with yourself. That's the first step in any commanding of righteousness. The proper way is to start with yourself. You should remind yourself of righteousness and then command the others. Does not mean that you are, for example, it does not mean that, for example, if we got an example of someone who's not doing something, doing something prohibited or something unrighteous, he can still advise other people. Like, for example, someone is in drugs. It's very well possible, and it's also desirable that he will tell other people, please don't take drugs. I got these drugs and I am addicted. I am now in trouble. Don't fall in trouble. This is a good advice. But also, he did not forget himself. Also, he gave himself as an example. I'm stuck in it. I cannot get out of it so easily. So don't get in this trap. Then the one who is admonished and advised should not say, think about yourself alone. No, he thought about himself. He gave himself as an example. Yes, I am stuck in this mess. I acknowledge that I'm in a messy situation and I have difficulty getting out, but don't go there first in the first place. That's a good advice. That you can, such a person, you cannot accuse that he forgot himself. He did not forget himself. But not do the job in himself completely because he is weak or he has to overcome certain addiction issues and so on. But still, I would say this one did admonish himself also, and he's trying to get out of it, and he's at least criticizing himself and admitting mistakes. And this state of affair, while they are reciting at least the scripture, the mere recitation of the scripture will show that clearly, that this is not a proper state of affair. If you admonishing people of righteousness, like they were admonishing the people of the most important admonishment they have to the people of Medina, is to tell them, soon the Prophet will come, you are pagan, we will join the Prophet and fight against you and exterminate you if necessary, because they were usually the underdog in Medina, because the Arab tribes are, generally the Arab tribes have been more vicious and more warmongering than the Jews, generally in Arabia. The Arabs in the peninsula, secluded for thousands of years, become really a warrior people. And the Jews are more a docile, submissive, persecuted people. They don't have the mentality of fighting viciously. So they were most often, they're not defeated. And most of the time, they restore to playing business relation, to do political plotting, constructing alliances, etc. So the usual way, the weak one or the one who is not good at fighting will be good at cunning. For example, like the British, let's face it, the British are known, they're best in cunningness, are known in fighting, confrontation, real confrontation. They have never succeeded in a real confrontation without the help of others, neither First World War nor when they tried to invade Afghanistan, etc. But always through cunningness, playing factions against each other and so on. So, but someone reciting, though, even just reciting, not even reading, الأخوان الذين يريدون أن تقرؤون الكتاب، لا أنت تتلون، just reciting، تلاوة is just reciting. The first level of attending the scripture is to recite them, to read them. The reading in the sense of reciting, just reading the words and the sounds, first step. Then comes the understanding of the meaning of words and so on, then sentences and deeper meaning, etc. There's various levels. That will be the real reading in Arabic sense, or in English. Like this rank in the university, you say he's appointed as a reader. What does mean reader? He just recites? No. He studies, he analyzes, and he instructs his students how to study and analyze. He's a reader. He's not just a reciter. Want to talk about kitab. And this also in Arabic. In Arabic, in scholars, in what we call in English, in the English, scholars or clergy, they were called in the first century at least qurra, the reader. They were not called ulama. The word ulama was reserved only for those who are known to be pious and righteous and fearing Allah, according to the Quran. But that these people of scholarship, these people of reading, qurra, because nobody will, if someone say, I am alim, he will be, people will look at him, how can you know that you are real alim, that you have really the fruit of knowledge, that you have the understanding and respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which comes from real knowledge. You are just a reader, you are just a scholar, you are a clergy, that's all. Clergy comes from clerics, from writer, from people of writing, people of the pen, but you are not a people of deep thought and deep commitment and deep beliefs, not yet. You may be, but you should not praise yourself. So that's the first century. You barely find anyone. Maybe you say about someone else, he's an alim, but not about yourself. I am a qari, I am a qurra. So yeah, then afala taqil, don't you, Asad said, don't you, Muhammad Asad said? Because the word taqilun is, aql, aql is the best translation for aql is rationalization, use reason. Afala taqilun, don't you rationalize.
Can you not then use your reason?
Use reason or rationalize. Don't you rationalize? Don't you use your reason? I think use reason or rationalize are essentially equivalent. In Arabic, you have also the verb ya'qil, and we have aql. أَلَا تَسْتَخْدِمُونَ عُقُولَكُمْ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ Don't you rationalize? Don't you use your reason? Don't you belong to the rational people who can use their reason properly? So this is one important issue with the commanding good and forbidding evil, which people often misunderstand, is that it is a major failure of many of those who command good and forbid evil that they look to the faults of the others and start criticizing and possibly admonishing and advising, and they ignore themselves and ignore working on themselves. I said there are exceptions, like for example this drug addict, but he most likely, he will be admitting his misery of his situation, that he has difficulty fixing it, and he may use that as an argument to advise the other not to fall in drugs. That's good. That's still this one. We cannot say really genuinely that he forgot himself. Yes, he did not succeed with himself yet, but does not negate that he. On the other hand, for the recipient, for the one who is being admonished, he should understand and rationalize what he been presented to him. Not take escape, but you are not doing that, what you are saying. That's not a good argument. That's a bad argument. It's a dangerous argument. Yes, that one is then has committed a failure, but for the one who is admonished and advised, he should not take that as an argument. He should say, this is good advice. This is a good point of view. I should rationalize it in its own merits. And there's also a statement attributed to Isa alayhi salam in the New Testament said, listen to their words, but don't follow their deeds. So because the Pharisees and the scribes and so on were corrupt in their deeds and so on, but usually they admonish and give advice according to the scripture. So she, listen to that advice. If it's a good advice found in the scripture, take it. Don't be moved to reject that advice or this admonishment just because the one who gave it is having failing in his way, in his acts and in his deeds. That's not a good excuse. This is also a way of the devil to divert you from the issue. The issue is that he tell you, for example, don't take this drugs. This is harmful for your mental and body health and also for spiritual health. In the case he's founding that on a religion, or don't smoke. Like when your doctor tell you don't smoke, it's not a good argument to say he is also smoking. That's not a good argument. He don't smoke, he's having a good reason and a good justification on medical ground. take that. His failing to do that is negative on him, but should not be negative on you, should not be bright for you. So it is two-sided, which has been through it. This side is this, because the side is to admonish Bani Israel and criticize them and make them feel negative about themselves and show them that you have considerable failing and you have lack of rationalization, plenty of it. So don't praise yourself, because they used to praise you. You are a people in the scripture. We are the people who are a sophisticated nation, a nation of culture and literature. And these Arabs are just a bunch of camel boys and backward the nation, which don't have any scripture, any prophets. Well, yeah, it's maybe true, but does not justify that you are failing also in being up to the standard of your own scripture. If you were to be rational, people who are rationalized, you would not have fallen in that trap. You would have worked on yourself first and foremost, and then when you recognize your limitation and your capabilities, then you will be able and you will be justified to admonish the others. And even if you, in the case, like as I said, the example of the drug addict, you have also in such a situation also say, I am addicted, I am in trouble, and I'm working on it, still not successful, but don't fall in it. That's a good advice, and coming from someone who did not forget himself, who criticized himself and trying to correct himself. And this should be taken as a part of the admonishment, as a valuable contribution. Someone who decides the scripture and does not come to this conclusion, at least, is definitely not using his ear. He's not rationalized. He's just blabbering like a monkey, repeating sounds and words and maybe singing them in hymns and things, but really not benefiting anything from that, from these scriptures. So this recitation did not develop further in any benefit to be drawn from scripture. And the scripture, Old Testament, New Testament, if you read them, definitely you will come to this conclusion. Despite of all omissions, despite of all fabrication, despite of all shortcomings, despite of all myths intermixed there, still the general core, the general line is clear. The general line is clear, without any doubt. And the further admonishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what helps in that, because this is not easy to become rational, not easy to just go from just recitation of the scripture to more level of deeper understanding, level by level, according to your capability. Obviously, selected few will be going to the deep depths of scholarship, and the majority will be just having the top level of evident meaning. But anyone rationalizing should get at least this from the scripture, that you don't command people with something unless you have worked on yourself with that at least. And if you did not succeed, you take your non-success, your shortcoming, your failure as an example for the other to warn him to fall in the same trap like you. So this way you are admitting that you are still in the process of self-purification.
Sheikh, in this context,
yeah,
this rebuke, is it generic or was it on specific events that occurred? Was there a specific asbab and nuzul to warrant this ayah, or was it generally addressing?
It's general. That's because they were usually the one who taking the high chair and pretending to be the people of scholarship, and they tell the Arabs, you are pagans, you are worship useless idols, you are this, you are this, you are this. When a prophet will come, that was the main thing. When a prophet will come, we will join him, and we will be the real fighter who will defeat you. That was the general scheme with the surrounding pagan Arabs. So there's no specific single event, but it's general behavior.
Understood.
Yeah?
Okay. Understood.
Then this is not an easy job. Establishing prayer, giving zakat, joining the wudah, and then commanding the people good and admonishing righteousness and spreading righteousness and goodness in the society and around you, and while criticizing yourself and trying to improve it, which entails that you recognize your own shortcoming, you don't become self-righteous, etc. All of that is not easy. It needs help. It needs, the help is needed is really a spiritual help. It's not a physical issue. This is an issue of character, of mentality, of controlling your own will. And the main tools which help, not the exclusive one, but the main things which help in that is taking help. You may read it in English first. In the next ayah, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ.
Okay, so for Muhammad Asad, and seek aid in steadfast patience and prayer. Mm-hmm. And this indeed is a hard thing for all, but the humble in spirit.
Yeah. Okay.
And the other translation, I find it better, is seek help in endurance and prayers.
Mm-hmm.
Doing this is a burden except for the humble.
Yeah. So that's it. So say the meaning is clear, to overcome all of these difficulties, because this is not easy to remember yourself first when you want to admonish people of righteousness. That means first you have to understand, you have to know what's righteousness. You have to be striving to, because if you are living like an animal, like many people in the West, unfortunately, after the widespread secularization, which is now firm, we have now maybe the third generation or the fourth generation of purely secular. Three generations back, the people were not purely secular. They still have been grown up with some manners or some etiquettes or some general principles from scripture, or at least verbally. But recent generations, last generation now, they are starting their jobs at the earning life phase. They have barely heard at home anything related to righteousness and piety, anything like that. Nothing is. They may be hearing about something about human rights, a bit of honesty in dealing, and a bit of accounting the government, but nothing really going to the fundamental, the proper foundation, which may put that on fair base. That's coming from relation and connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you don't have this level, then it's impossible for you to fulfill that job to start with. But that's the first start. Then there will be some recitation of the scripture. Then it will, but for all of that, it's not easy. This is not straightforward disease. So the secular life is very easy, people. I will mention a small story after that, small story. To do this hard job, you need help. You need to take help. First one is endurance. Now, how can you take help of endurance? Is by admonishing yourself that I have to be patient. I have to force myself to endurance. I have to look every morning in the mirror and say to myself, this is a new day. Let us try to do something better today. You have to address yourself. That's meaning ista'ala bil-sabr. Al-sabr is not a natural characteristic you are born with. Some people are having more endurance and more like level of pain. They can suffer more pain than others. Yeah, that's especially physical pain. But burden of commitment, endurance in hardship. We'll come later on what kind of sabr is available in the Quran. As mentioned, there are three types of sabr. But here's just a general sabr, the general endurance, which entails all the three endurances, which will be, maybe I will mention some of them now, then we discuss them later when the ayah about the better comes. That has to be by self-persuasion. Otherwise, and self-training. That means ta'inub al-sabr, meaning initiate sabr in yourself by reminding yourself, I have to be sabr, I have to do that. And this means that you have at least a step number zero, that this must be done to achieve righteousness and to achieve purity and achieve pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's based on the foundation that true happiness is achieving the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and succeeding in akhirah. That's the true happiness. All other happinesses are minor and below that. And that's based on the belief that Allah exists and there's a day of judgment and accounting. If you don't have that, why should I have sabr? That's the reason atheists and seculars and so on who have no firm religious beliefs, they usually collapse easily and commit suicide, for example. It's a very easy way. My life is miserable. I cannot endure it anymore. The best thing is just terminate it and get out of it, because he thinks getting out of it, he will be out. In reality, he's not out. He's in a major trouble after that. But he has never been educated or have never been pondered about that there may be after death, it could be even worse. That life, that there may be a life after death, at least ponder the issue of maybe, and so on. So that's ista'inu bil-sabr. But also, admonishing myself with endurance, but also prayer. Prayer will give you considerable energy to overcome hardships and to admonish yourself of, command yourself of good and evil, remind you of the relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least, bring that in the foreground of the mind. You may have it deep inside yourself, but it's not active and not present. The prayer, that's the reason all revealed religions, at least since Ibrahim downward, they have regular prayer in the day. 1, 3, 5, doesn't matter. But some pray at the end of the day, so you have an opportunity to have self-purification, self-reminder. And in another place, one of the main functions of the salah and its purposes is to admonish of yourself and prevent yourself from committing evil. And because salah commands good and forbids evil, but more important is remind you of Allah Ta'ala, connect with Allah Ta'ala, because this is the foundation upon which everything can be built. So take help from sabr, endurance, and salah. Let's see, later in Quran, the types of endurance are mentioned, because most people think endurance is essentially so, there's a calamity, you endure it by not completely collapsing or indulge in lamentation. That's what the people most likely think sabr. That's sabr in hardship. But that's not only. There is sabr in hardship, there's sabr in good times. How come? Because in good times you tend to forget the hardship of the other, you forget about akhirah, you forget about, because everything is smooth, life is very beautiful, you forget about that there will be accounting. Even if it's smooth and good now, there will be accounting. Just the fact that there will be accounting will, wealth could be easily more devastating than poverty and hardship. So you have to have this endurance. صابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس. And there's also endurance in the battlefield, in the direct confrontation with an enemy, be it in the battlefield or being in a confrontation, ideological confrontation. That requires also endurance and firmness and holding your position, your fighting position, not running away, not failing. So sabr is a multi-branched affair, and it's of fundamental importance. Without a minimal amount, fundamental amount of sabr, you will not succeed in akhirah. But with plenty of sabr, you will be succeeding even without any accounting. You will be rewarded without account, as the Quran says in another place. So sabr is fundamental. As-salah is obviously the one act which symbolizes the real worship. Real worship means recognizing Allah as the ultimate sovereign and the creator and the controller of the universe. And this fact, maybe deep in the brain and the subconscious, has to be brought up every now and then, possibly regularly in the regular salah, but also in other irregular salah, in other salah in the general sense of prayers and dua and supplication, so that it's present and active in your behavior. And then you will be able to force yourself just not to rely on the recitation. You will go deeper, and then you force yourself into rationalization. Because rationalization and being rational is not an easy job. It's easy to be to just follow the head, to be like an idiot, to just when good food is there, you enjoy good food. When it's bad food, you curse the bad day. That's easy. That's trivial. To be above that, you have to take the aid of salah and sabr. And this now, وإنها, it is now that it is. Does it go to salah or to sabr? Most likely, it goes to salah, because salah is feminine. Innaha is it would have been sabr. Sabr is masculine. In Arabic, it would be innahu. So it's about salah. So obviously, in the stages, sabr is an important aid, but higher than it and more important is prayer. In a function of aid, but also this salah, innaha lakabira. It is difficult. It is heavy. Except for those who are khashi'in. Khashi' means those who are humble and submissive. How did Hamad Asa translate it? Rash?
1 second. We should bring it back. Humble in spirit.
Humble in spirit, yeah. Khashi'in. Khushu'. Khushu' is used very often without people understand the meaning of it. In salah, khushu' meaning being focused. Not doing movements which do not belong to salah, meaning focus on salah and focusing in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not like, for example, continuously fixing your clothes. Yeah, you may need sometimes something's a jacket is not sitting properly, you make it sit properly. Sometimes you need to sneeze, you sneeze in your handkerchief. That does not contradict khushu', because this activity must be done necessarily. What had to be done. Sometimes even the door knocks and then you need to go to the door and open it. That does not contradict. But khushu' means focused on salah and doing only the the things related to Salah, including the mental focusing, and the most important thing is the spiritual focusing. So the real khushu' is the khushu' of the heart, like the focus and humility of the heart. Because khash'a is meaning becoming low, becoming submissive, becoming illa al-khashi'in. And then there is explanation, what these al-khashi'in? What, how can you see that? How you can judge who is khashi'a or who is not khashi'a? And what make you become khashi'a, become humble, and it comes in the next ayah. So salah is very heavy and very difficult. And we know that for someone who is used from childhood or for a house who are musallin, and he brought up in performing salah with the family, and then going with his father or her father to the masjid, and it looks like easy, but in reality it is awfully difficult for who did not get used to it and make it part of their life. If it becomes part of your life, then you even organize your calendar around salah. It doesn't become heavy. You think it's not heavy. You think it's light because you have got it into a routine and because you got the job done yearly. Now you are getting the fruit. But to start, it's very heavy and extremely difficult. And you see it for many non-practicing Muslims when they try to go back to Islam, or non-Muslims when they embrace it. Non-Muslims when they embrace Islam, because they come usually from disbelief into belief, and they're full of spiritual and creedual energy. And then they can start and they proceed. And then they try to adjust their life bit by bit around that. But Muslims who are coming from nominal Islam to practice to actual Islam, they have considerable difficulty adjusting to putting Salah in their life schedule, and also benefiting from Salah in the general sense, not of a formal player, but also Salah meaning Dua, being adding Dua to all their life and to their transaction, and supplicating in every occasion, making dhikr at every opportunity, which the dhikr to be made. That's not easy. That's very difficult, except for those who are humble, submissive in spirit. Now, who is this submissive spirit? Some of their explanation, at least one main feature, which makes you humble in spirit, which make you predestined for humility in spirit, is the one in the next ayah. What does it say? What does the next ayah say in English?
Next ayah is, who know with certainty that they shall meet their sustainer, and that unto him they shall return.
Yeah. What's the literal translation? Because there's one word here which has dual meaning. What is the literal one?
One second. So 46. I'll go for word by word. So, sorry, second. Those who believe that they will meet their Lord and that they to him will return.
Mm-hmm. So that they struggled with the word here. It's actually also the Islamic scholarship has struggled. The Quran uses the word, those who yadhunnun, one is actually conjecture, which entails some sense of doubt. It's usually the opposite of in the usual, the most common use is also in another place in the Quran, say, إِنَّ الظَّنَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْءٍ. The ظن, that the conjecture, the assumption, does not substitute for the full truth, for the well-established حق. Is that what established? حق meaning is firm, the well-established. The one which is either established, you know it is established by necessity of reason, or by necessity of immediate perception, that fire burns. If you are in doubt, put your finger, then you see what happens to you. That's with certainty. That's al-haq, and also what can you deduce from that with a valid evidence. Obviously, you don't know about your evidence or your burhan or the chain of arguments is valid, but other people can double check it. And when a community of scholars have double checked it, then the probability will sink lower and lower, or that it may have an error there. So that is haq. The opposite of that is dhan, which is better translated, not doubt. The doubt is shak, but conjecture, dhan.
So in this translation, he's got the exact opposite of the meaning then. Do classical
I will tell you, that's the one in the meaning. But in certain situations, it's used to substitute for firm conjecture, firm conviction. There may be a hint that whatever you are believing in Akhirah, that traditional belief is better. When we take belief in the way that, for example, used in English, for example, say, did so and so happen? They say, yes, you don't answer sometimes. If you don't know for certain, you answer, I believe so. I have a conjecture, I have a belief, but not absolute certitude. To the level of certitude of seeing something by your own eyes or touching it with your own skin or recognizing it by necessity of reason. So that may be a hint from the Quran that belief, so in ghaib, including, for example, akhirah and so on, is not necessarily going ever to reach the level of absolute haqq because you have not seen it, you have not experienced it, so you are relying on a report. And there is always a point to that. Did I understand correctly? Was it like that? So there would be some kind of conjecture there for you. Only for Allah it is absolute haqq. For you it is a conjecture. Maybe it's a hint. But other said, dhan is one of the called the words which can convey contradictory meaning. Could convey shak. Or could convey certitude. That is supported by the ayah when they in yawm al-qiyamah, when they are questioned about it, they say, "Nama kunna nadhunnu dhannan wa ma nahnu bimustayqinin." We are just having conjectures, doubtful one. We are not in certitude. So it's not really straightforward doubt, but it is knowledge or perceiving something with less than absolute certitude.
Sheikh, in other areas of the Quran, it always refers to it. I always understood that when aqeedah is invoked, it's always in the context of qat'i and yaqeen.
Yeah, no doubt about that. It's qat'i, yaqeen, nadhari, because you have to analyze it and you say that it's by necessity, it has to be like that. But what is nadhari, after a chain of conclusion, does not appear to everyone the same way like appear to you if you touch the fire.
Okay, like firsthand, you know.
Immediate perception. Immediate perception, or by overwhelming tawatur, like for example, was England covered rained several hundred years ago by a queen called Elizabeth? Yes, you don't say. I believe that's okay. We don't, without doubt, because all reports from French, from English, from other nations, from local, from the Turks indicate that there was a queen called Elizabeth. That's qat'i. It's tawatur. You cannot reject it from yourself without doubting your own mind.
But even Aqidah can reach that point in the sense that, so for example, so in this particular context, it from the context, it looks like it's because it's a revocation.
Yeah.
And in one of the translations, it's assume. It gives the impression that, yes, this is below a level required.
That's what I'm saying. Maybe the Quran is hinting that this will be ilm nadhari, will be. It is qat'i nadhari based on the evidence, but how do we know that you will meet your Lord and that you will come back to? Is that only because you have received the assurance from him through messengers? That's the chain of argument. This is not immediately present in the mind like the presence of the pain or the fire when you touch it. It's different that different presence.
You know, in previous halakas, when you, for example, in your own evaluation of hadith and everything. And just the amount of material that's there, you always feel in your works that there's a divine hand behind this.
Yeah, you feel
that, and you previously, for example, in the previous miracles, there was something visual, but your valuation of them is when it's an intellectual miracle, it's a much stronger conviction.
Yeah, but
how do you reconcile that with this then?
No, for example, after you make the conclusion, it becomes a yaqeen. As good as the other one, but you have to do the conclusion. It's not immediate.
So maybe this ayah, for example, is it this ayah itself? Is this kind of building the picture? Because generally speaking, this Surah Baqarah in the beginning, you can tell that Allah is bringing a kind of picture bit by bit.
Mm-hmm.
For example, showing not even in chronology, but in Naman Ali Khan, for example, he says it's not chronological, but it builds the picture. Do you remember when you did this? Do you remember it was, you know, all these kind of things? Is this in the same way? Allah is sort of showing the picture that you doubt in this and then building a kind of narrative to say that it's, all of this indicates that you're below the required threshold. Is that what's happening here in this instance?
Possibly. As I said, that the Quran uses here, assuming I say that the Quran is from Allah, it could have been rhyming and also having the same wasn, and you can sing it the same way. If you said, instead of الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ, you could say الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ. It sounds very nicely. You can sing it the same way. You can recite it the same way with all tajweed. But instead of يَعْلَمُونَ, علم is usually firm knowledge. يقين is used the word يظنون, which must have some hint. Now the hint has had to be explained. Some scholars said it is, they solved the problem by saying the word ظن, the Quran wants to tell us that the word ظن could be used in Arabic in two meanings, just conjecture or certitude. That's a possibility. That's a possibility. You can read it from the Quran. Because believing in Akhirah is definitely required with certitude. Otherwise, you are not certain about Allah's promise. You are not certain about the revelation. Then you are not a believer. You have doubt. But it could be hinting that so they have the solution that you are certain about that. You are confident with certitude. Come on, if you say, you know, you will never leave the level of a solid certitude and the knowledge. You can say that certitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is still a conjecture in that level. So I'm just hinting that point. Take that on the, and it needs maybe much deeper analysis of the internal state of the heart. This is more related to the internal state and conviction of the heart. Like, for example, like I said, the people, the human beings will continue discussing who created it, who created it. They say, that Allah created everything then. And then they say, who created Allah? When you reach this level, then say, A'udhu billahi min shaitanir and stop, because he has no creator. Because the devil will know that the concept of necessary existing, which has no creator, is beyond control of the mind. It is by necessity of reason, you know, there must be all the chain of events must end with the necessary existing being. But still, you are unable to take it because you have some atheists run away to infinity. This there's no initial. It goes ad infinitum, going actually in nothing, because ad infinitum is zero, is nil. Going limit of sequence one over n is going to zero, is nothing remaining. That's the meaning of it. Infinite regress, meaning there's no cause whatsoever. I mean, the fundamental principle of reason is gone. So they escape from this to this, from this to this, because the human capacity of imagining or comprehending is not as wide as the capacity of rationalization and regarding the limits and the border. That's the reason, for example, in mathematics, you can study limits and you know that a limit is zero, but imagining it and going step by step is not possible, because as a finite being, you cannot imagine yourself going infinite many steps. And this led to the famous arrow paradox of the Greek, etc. All because there's the possibility to rationalize and control with mathematical precision the limiting process, but there's no way to visualize it somehow with the eye of the mind. But let's leave it at that. The other interpretation is the word "yadhunun" could be in some context meaning being certain, sometimes be just conjecturing, depending upon the context. That's Arabic language, allow for both. And there are some words in Arabic which could indicate a meaning and the opposite of it, depending upon the context. We'll have examples maybe along the way. So just a hint. We're doing a hint. I don't want to increase it more than that. But we know from other evidence of the Quran that you have to be believing in Akhirah, sufficient level to make you believing in Allah and His Messenger, because it's based on that. It is not by immediate experience. It's just relying on Allah's promise and report, because there's no necessary reason dictating there must be an Akhirah. There's none. It's only the report that it's coming. So who is this khashi'in? Those humble in spirit, those who, let's translate it to the other translation, who are firmly convinced within human capability, which is expressed by the way, the balloon possibly, but this needs maybe a study by itself. أنهم ملاقوا ربهم, that they will meet the Lord and that they will be retained to Him. It seems to be like some redundancy. They will meet their Lord and they return to Him, but it's not redundancy, because meeting the Lord is not necessary that you are retained to Him. This conveys some part of the meaning is to another meeting. So they will meet the Lord, but before that, they will be returned back to Him for accounting. And then hopefully after that, passing the accounting, they will meet Him then in the paradise in good reception. These are who, or that's maybe that's a reason they will know, because it the part that you will meet your Lord in pleasure is only a promise, and you may doubting yourself if being worthy of that promise. I'm worthy of that promise, or I'm not worthy of that promise. So such lingering doubt may come back and forth in the mind, preventing it from being absolute certitude, like the certitude of the fire hurting you if you touch it. So how come that this belief, this firm belief, up to the level of what we discussed that about dhan and yaqeen, and immediate perception and non-immediate perception, how come that this will make you humble in spirit? But it's very obvious, because if you know that you will be retained to your Lord, retained for what? What retained? Retained for accounting. Well, this is abbreviated in the Quran, abbreviates in this place, because it's the common perception of all human beings when they addressed Akhirah and the Day of Judgment, is usually Day of Judgment and Day of Resurrection. After that will be accounting. There's no ideology or religion ever advocated in Akhirah without no accounting. Otherwise, there will be no Akhirah, just expiration, nothing else, like the animals. So, going back for accounting, meaning you will be subject to accounting, you are subject to questioning, meaning that you are capable of being a successful person or a failure. You have weaknesses, you have shortcomings, and you have to humble yourself. You have to recognize that you have to humble yourself. You have to account yourself now before accounting there. If the belief in Akhirah does not make you humble yourself and criticize yourself and doubt yourself, meaning there's some error in the belief in Akhirah. There's some fundamental error in the belief. Like, for example, if some Christian, not all Christian, by the way, early Christian believe that the statement that Jesus died for their sin, meaning for every sin, not only for the original sin, for every sin, although even the original sin is a false belief, but let's just assume this one. And they took liberties, all prohibitions of the Old Testament, including sodomy, including usury, is allowed. And Paul was himself fighting against this heresy in his epistles for Eli. So he took all sin. In that case, Akhirah is just going... Akhirah has lost the standard meaning of being first stage of accounting, which is enforced in the Old Testament and all the other philosophies. So then you will not be humble, because you will not recognize yourself being a failure if committing sin, because the sins have been all erased. Isa will carry them, for example, because you have a wrong understanding of Akhirah. So the wrong understanding of Akhirah or non-belief in Akhirah will have the effect that you are not ready to be criticizing yourself and looking to yourself to yourself and trying to correct it, because it's okay. Why should I correct myself? I'm fine. You will not be very happy. The same with the Jews, their mistake that the Akhirah is recorded for them, the reason for many of their failings, they believe that they bear to being Jews. They will be a purgatory, they will be punishment, but they ultimately ending in paradise. Whatever punishment had been administered to them, it will be only for a limited number of days. Just a few days will be touched by the fire, and after that we'll enter the paradise. We're guaranteed, finish, over. This way you'll never become humble, and you'll never bother about commanding the people, commanding yourself, and getting the righteousness and the purity. Maximum will be just a few days in hellfire. Then we'll be out. Then you can fool yourself this way. You not become khashi, you not become humble. So these who believe firmly, or these who conjecture that they're meeting their Lord, and they will going back to him for accounting. And the accounting is following some fundamental principles which will not change. There will be nobody giving special accounting or special treatment than anybody else. This is implicitly in that. So the Jewish belief that there's an Akhirah and so on is deficient, not in matter of wealth, but in the matter of the understanding of the meaning of Akhirah and the possibility that they will never meet their Lord. They will be returned to their Lord, getting the account, but never meet their Lord in paradise, because they deserve, they got out of the fold of belief and deserve eternal damnation. That's not in their calculation. That's the reason they took quite a considerable amount of liberties, because they have this false belief about Akhirah and about accounting. So it will not produce the necessary humility and submission of the spirit. So that's very important that Jesus, not just a conjecture that or a firm belief, whatever it is, a conjecture with the almost certitude or the certitude that you will be meeting your Lord. Meeting the Lord is usually, we meet someone, usually meeting for meeting in pleasure and you will be received by your Lord in a nice meeting and nice reception after being retained to him after accounting is only if you have the correct belief about that. That you will not be receiving your Lord unless you have passed the accounting as it should be. If you don't have this correct understanding of Akhirah, you will never be the one who's khashi' and having the humility of the spirit. Now then, a group of other addresses, these are general addresses to Bani Israel, general principles. Nothing in detail about their history and how much favor Allah bestowed on them, just to excite. Because if you mention someone how much favor he has, how much luck he has in time past, that may invite him to become thankful and appreciating. So the next block, we started with the Ya Bani Israel, or children of Israel.
O children of Israel, remember those blessings of mine with which I graced you and how I favored you above all other people.
Mm-hmm. So this meaning is clear. So remember that. The favors, my favor, the favors with details of some favors will come after that. And these favors are from Allah. It's not by their own doing, nor by they are for some reason or another deserving. Actually, most likely they didn't deserve those favors. Genuinely, by their own deeds and their own abilities, almost certainly they did not deserve it. It was just maybe a promise to Ibrahim and Ishaq and Yaqub and the fulfillment of Allah's promise, but it is genuinely an completely initiated favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Allah bestowed on them. And then He gave them a certain rank and preference over the rest of Alameen of the world. Obviously, Alameen, we talk about the Alameen of the earth and the creation of the earth because. Whatever Alameen is said tafdeel by being elevated over Alameen, it means of the various people of the earth and other creature of the earth, which we know and we don't know, like humans and jinn, they are definitely other creatures are definitely inferior to human beings generally, and human beings, some of them are preferred over the others with revelation and certain bestowances. More details of that will come further, but this tafdeel is connected with what mentioned up there of the covenant, that they fulfill a covenant, then Allah will fulfill His covenant to keep them, giving them the preference. But if they break the covenant, then the preference will be gone. So it's not like they claim that they have, that's again show that they are not khashi'in, they are not humble in spirit. They think this preference is eternal and cannot be abrogated or cancelled. It's actually, even if that preference cannot be abrogated, if it is a real unconditional preference, but the preference was given under condition to fulfill Allah's covenant. So remember that. That's just reminding them. Then it will come more of admonishment and also mentioning of these favors and some of the stories, which has various purposes, which we'll discuss each one by itself. So let's continue with the next ayah. وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا
Second. And remain conscious of the coming of a day when no human being shall in the least avail another, nor shall intercession be accepted from any of them, nor ransom taken from them, and none shall be succored.
Or supported, or finding help, shall find victory. So, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا protect yourself, or be conscious of, that's all good translation. We said taqwa meaning protect yourself. Ward evil from yourself. So protect yourself. Ward evil. Ward the dangers of a day. تَقُوا يَوْمًا In Arabic it says, ward the day. We say in Arabic, ward the day. But actually, ward the dangers of the day. Ward the dangers of the day. Which day is that? In which no soul will be able to compensate for another soul whatsoever. No compensation. Nobody can say, I am going to compensate for this guy or carry some of his sin, or just the opposite. If anyone is there available, they will be ready to dump their sins on you, not to take anything or give you any, or to ask them for some of their good deeds. They say, sorry, we cannot give you anything. So nobody will give you anything from his good deeds, nor anyone will be willing to take some of your sins. Just the opposite. Everyone will be striving to take to take from your good deeds and dump his sins on you as much as possible. That's out of question. That's what we want to happen. That's the official of the Qiyamah. لا تجزي نفس عن نفس شيئا. Nobody will be compensating in behalf of somebody else. That's one way to get out of trouble, that you find someone like a guarantor who carry some of the liability instead of your nizlan. Forget about this. Nobody can give you liability in your place. Carrying the liabilities meaning either pay off instead of you or give you from what he has so that you can't pay off. Neither is available. Out of question. ولا تقول منها شفاعة. And there will be no intercession accepted. Now in the Quran and other places, there will be shafa'ah with the permission of Allah Ta'ala. But here, in addressing Bani Israel, it's important to say, he there for you and for the likes of people of you who broke the covenant, I permit any shafa'ah, I will not accept. Even your prophets who are keen to save you, their shafa'ah for you will not be accepted. Because you broke the covenant. ولا تقول منها شفاعة. And even if someone come for us say, Allah permit me to shafa'a, Allah said, no, you are not permitted. I'm not accepted. So even if Musa come forward and say, these are my people, this way all Jews come still, they are my people, I feel connected to them. Am I allowed to do intercession? Allah said, no, you are not allowed to do any intercession for them. ولا تقول منها شفاعة. So either someone coming forward to offer shafa'a, no shafa'a will be permitted. And even if he offers, it will not be accepted. ولا يأخذ منها. What was another way to escape that you can pay off yourself ransom? Say, okay, I have committed this and this. Like for example, in Dunia, you kill someone by intentionally, but not by plotting or what they call it, first degree murder, second degree murder. You have a fight in the street. You pulled the lever and struck him in the head, killed him in anger. Okay, in Islamic law, you can buy yourself from the punishment, which is death penalty. With the acceptance of the blood guardian by paying blood money. Yeah, you can ransom yourself with blood money. You can offer blood money, you can offer even more blood money than usual. There's limited amount that you offer to persuade. But in your qiyamah, you have nothing to pay. And even if you have anything to pay, like if you have good deed, it will not be accepted. You cannot pay from good deeds. I have good deeds. Take it as a compensation. So I say, no. That's not how it works here. That cannot be accepted as a compensation. But I could mean adl. Adl is a compensation or a ransom. Adl means justice or equality. Equal compensation. No. There's maybe another way that you find someone who is powerful enough to come for help, to save you, for bail you, somehow, something like that, or by force. Who can be in the division with having the force, which can force Allah to release them? Is impossible. There's none, no entity, neither Yawm al-Qiyamah, no now, no in eternity, back or forth, who is able to give you victory against Allah. It's impossible. This is contradict necessity of reason. It's impossible to defeat Allah if he insists to have you. Nobody can save you from it. So nobody will give you victory. And this, all of these things mostly have been phrased in the passive tense because no entity in existence can be. So no need to say no entity there. You will not find any nasr, any support, any help. So that's first, remember my favor on you. So become thankful. Secondly, in addition to that, or in substitute of that, if you are so hard-hearted that you don't remember favor, then protect yourself from that. And most human beings tend to be more worried about punishment than appreciating benefits. What started with the higher rank? The higher rank is that you start appreciating as a benefit. Because of that, you behave properly. But unfortunately, a minority of human beings are those who appreciate favor and act accordingly. Like appreciating most humans, they don't even recognize Allah's favor on them by giving them life, giving power, giving energy, giving them everything they need, and just giving this freedom of choice and this capability of believing or disbelieving, of managing their life, controlling their destiny. And they don't appreciate that. They don't thank Allah at it by recognizing him as the ultimate sovereign and performing just a couple of prayers a day and giving a small fraction of their money and wealth. Even not that they are not willing. Most human beings are like only few selected few, the high ranking ones, the highest ranking ones. the majority has to be shown the stick, otherwise they will misbehave. So he, after inviting them to be at the highest level of behavior, which is appreciation and this, and acknowledgement of Allah's favor, then if not, alternatively, remember this day in which nothing can help, absolutely nothing. All four possible options of escaping punishment and tormentation are not available on the Qiyamah. Some may be available with his permission, but especially for Israel in this address, the permission is not mentioned, meaning for you, there will be no permission. Forget about that. Now, the side of some of the favors are mentioned. Favor by favor, we'll do maybe one of the favors or two before concluding for today.
Okay.
This has various reasons for mentioning them. First of all, certifying in history what has happened to clarify history and clean some of the mess in the old scripture, which is sometimes full of contradiction, fabrication, mixing up, and so on. That's all. And testifying for the core truth, which is there also, because the Quran testifies for the core truth. And there are the core truth, and there are fabrications and adjustment and deviation, quickly. And there's some hiding of certain stories which the Quran exposes and put on the table. Some, not all of them, because the Prophet did not come to expose and scandalize the previous nation in full, just to what is even necessary to show them the right way. So let us go the first favor.
And remember the time when we saved you from Pharaoh's people, who afflicted you with cruel suffering, slaughtering your sons and sparing only your women, which was an awful trial from your sustainer.
So now we mentioned that the worst thing, which is the beginning really of the tormentation of history, that we know another place of the Quran, this is in any case a Madani surah. In the Makki surahs, we have the surah of Yusuf, which shows the initiation, how when Israel settled in Egypt at first, they came there as a really high-ranking people. Their brother Yusuf, who was not the oldest, but the most favored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was a messenger to the people of Egypt. They didn't accept him, as we know from other places of the Quran. But he was also like a prime minister, like an aziz. That's essentially the prime minister of Egypt, and he was running and managing the affairs during the famine, or the pre-famine time, and preparing for the famine, which he was able by Allah's help to interpret that is going to happen according to the dream of the Pharaoh or of the king. The king of Egypt is not a Pharaoh, it was actually a king, and the Quran is very accurate. When we come to Surah Yusuf, we'll see the reason why it's not called Pharaoh, it's called king, because he's not from the Pharaoh of Egypt, it's most likely from the invading people of Asia, but that's for this time. Then they settled there. They decided to live there. Although Yaqub went back and was buried in somewhere in Palestine. Some people say, I'm not sure if he's buried with his father and grandfather in the cave in Hebron and Al-Khalil, or it is rather in the north near Nablus. Allah alam, I have to check that. But there's not of no importance. But the rest of his sons, living obviously royally in Egypt and well established, they preferred life in Egypt, a settled, beautiful life. And it went for that for several generations. Until then, the pharaohs, the genuine Egyptian kings, pharaohs, reconquered the north again and started, obviously, regarding the Israelites as like a fifth column and as foreigners, enslaved them. And then, based on a story which will come in detail, Pharaoh decided that these people are dangerous. So the best thing what we can do is essentially exterminate them. But exterminating them is having a great liability, because they have been taken to slavery and they were a very important productive force. So to reduce the danger, it was decided that the male children should be killed, but year on and year off, otherwise they would be exterminated, and only the woman who will do their servitude and all the kind of woman's work will be spared. Anyway, that's all details comes elsewhere. And in narration, who shall, well, there's a question mark with them, is that really the extermination of men was only for 1 year on, year, year off, but it seems to be like that, year on, year off. And sparing of female. And this indeed, that what Pharaoh did at that time, the time of the birth of Musa, Musa was born in that phase, roughly. That was considerable, obviously, that in addition to other tormentation and torture and mistreatment, it's unbelievable if you read it in the Old Testament and through history. But it's a standard of ancient times. Ancient time, they have invented all kind of cruelty and punishment and subjugation befitting for that time, where Pharaoh was regarded as a god on earth or the son of the gods. So he has unlimited power in torturing and mistreating people. And that one, what went through it, was did not happen against Allah. Well, it has with Allah's permission, and it was a great test and tormentation from your Lord. It was really a massive tribulation and test. So this is the favor is that they have been saved from this situation. Without divine intervention in a miraculous way, they would have been essentially exterminated. Few generations, they would have disappeared completely. The woman would have been taken by the Pharaoh and his soldiers and became Egyptian essentially, and becoming like if they ever used for breeding, and the men would have been exterminated and their seed would have been gone. And maybe the next ayah that this is how the saving have happened. But there was a big struggle until the next ayah had happened. So Quran is just giving the bullet points of the saving process, not going to the details of the struggle in Egypt. Next ayah, wa farqana bikum.
And when we cleft the sea before you and thus saved you and caused Pharaoh's people to drown before your very eyes.
Yeah, so the story is very complex. After long years, many years actually, struggle in Egypt, because they have been, the Egyptian had been, and the Pharaoh and his people were inflicted with various miraculous events. And every time when a miraculous event or calamity befell them, they address Musa, ask your Lord to lift this, then we will let you go with Bani Israel, go back to Palestine. And then every time they broke this, the last time when they called the ridges, which is seemed to be according to the Old Testament, if the story is true, and there's no reason to reject it, they were inflicted with some kind of a plague, which was very specific, because obviously not a standard plague. It's not like a coronavirus, which hits old and young. This one was hitting especially the firstborn, the eldest son of the family, which is a real calamity, because the eldest son, especially in a agricultural society, is the one who will inherit the land, usually. Like in England, it's the eldest one, actually, the one who inherits everything and keeps the integrity of the land and the wealth. So it will cause havoc for the whole society and for the societal development for decades to come. And then they promised, we will let you go with Bani Israel. And indeed, they did not interfere in the process of them departing. But then Pharaoh decided to break his word and pursue them. The pursuing process is also explained in much detail in the Old Testament and the history of the pursuance, etc. And also with a Jewish historian like Josephus in the Antiquity of the Jews, etc., until they reach to the seaside. Now the route taken is also divinely inspired. It seems to be it went to the place called Nuweibara in Egypt, Allahu A'lam. There were various discussions where it is. It's across the Nile. Some people claim it is the Red Sea at Aden. All of this is really nothing of respectable, no respectable scholarship can testify that. Then they were seeing the sea in front of them and the armies of Pharaoh approaching then the horizon behind them. And it was clear then next day it will be then the final slaughter, because there's no way the Israelite could, whatever the number may have been, or the number in the Old Testament is highly questionable. But independent of this, in the millions, it seems to be rather inconceivable, but still it is not out of the realm of possibility. Maybe there's some old mistake in translating a word like which indicate like 64, because the ancient times they do not have the decimal system, so it wouldn't have been 1,000, like maybe something like 64 has been. There's a specific word for that. Like for example, we have the word fortnight for two weeks and things like that. There may be a specific word for 64, and later generation misunderstood it to be indicating 1,000. So the numbers came the millions, and yet is only hundreds of thousands. Whatever, these are secondary points to be studied scholarly, just for interest of historically. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala performed an interview with Musa, another place in the Quran, told him, well, now we are, the sea is here. Did you bring, and then they started complaining as usual. You brought it us for our demise and destruction. Is that the saving you have promised us? As usual. And then Allah ta'ala inspired him to strike the sea with his stick, and the sea split in various channels. And the sea was like the water was standing like mountains, like high mountains, and the Bani Israel were able to go through to the other side, which is opposite in Arabia. It's roughly in the place which is near, in the same level or latitude of the city of Tabuk nowadays. There's a mountain they call Jabal al-Lawz. Some Christians claim this would be the Mount Sinai. In reality, Mount Sinai is a little bit south from that side. It's not in the current Sinai. That one is a historic mistake, geographic mistake, but this is, leave that for independent research and scholarship. It has some interest. And the Pharaoh and his army were in a state of shock, obviously. There is a story, most likely, I don't know if it's true or not, narrated that the angel Gabriel emerged in the form of a female horse, and then the horse of Pharaoh was charging behind that female horse right away in the abyss, in the sea. And the Pharaoh was obviously riding on battle carriage, which was at the time starting to be in news, was too proud to jump. That would break his pride. So he pretended that he's the one who gave the command to charge. And the army, like an idiot, as usual, charged behind the leader. And then when Bani Israel emerged to the other side, the last man, she came down, and Pharaoh and his army, essentially, most of them were drowning. They drowned in that. While the Israelite, Pharaoh and Musa and his people were on the other side, looking and seeing with their own eyes the whole army of Pharaoh being swept by the collapsing water, which was like high as a mountain, collapsing on them, and majority of them drowned. And that's what they reported. In the Old Testament, they reported that Pharaoh drowned. The Quran reported that Pharaoh's body has been saved and brought back to Egypt. And this will be an interesting point about comparing the veracity of the Quran and the veracity of the Old Testament compared with the Pharaoh documentation and so on, and the existing of mummies, etc. But this, even the job has not been completed now to a satisfaction. So this is an enormous favor. So first of all, what has happened in Egypt, sending Musa and Harun to Pharaoh, which stopped obviously the slaughter, and then was the challenge with all the various miracles happening. Yes, the prosecution continued and the punishment continued, but not as severe as before, because we are not there. Pharaoh and his ruling class were facing this man who claims to be a messenger and bringing quite a number of fantastic miracles. So they were busy with that, but they continued always oppressing the people and abusing them. And then when bailing out of Egypt, they faced this unbelievable situation in which the sea was split and they crossed over. So this is the two, several enormous favors in one go. The favors also continue. That's not all of it. We'll come to each other next time. I think it's enough for today. So we are stopped at the drowning of Pharaoh and his army.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have time for any questions, you think?
I think it's straightforward, but let's see.
Does anyone have any questions? Mukhtar, you like to speak?
Assalamu alaikum, my sheikh. How are you doing today?
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah, you knew the ayah that you mentioned about, which ayah was it? Let me get back to that. About wasta'inu bisabri wa salah. And I've got two questions, but I'll just keep to one today. If you look at Surah Mu'minun, it tells you in the first, second ayah, Allazihum fi salati khashi'un. And so the salah, and this is mentioned here. Sheikh, I want to know your view. How do you attain this khushu in salah? I mean, because I'm writing something on this for Friday, inshallah. I just want to know your view on this.
I think that this ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah guides where to the he described the khashi'in. The khushu' here is not the khushu' there. The khushu' there during salah. Here the khushu' which is the humility of the heart, which result from believing in Allah and their judgment and that they will be accountable and so on. So maybe this will give us the key for khushu' which will be the khushu' in salah. When you enter in salah, try your utmost to, which is quite difficult because nowadays with so many things, social media, news, etc. You just stop the television and you have difficulty focusing on the salah itself. And more often than not, you will notice that you have forgotten how many rak'ahs you did and so on, because life has been overloaded with bits of information, most of it useless, but it's enough to disturb the mind. So the struggle should be to try to make maybe making a fresh wudu, even if you have wudu, try to focus when. Try to focus about Akhirah, that Akhirah is definitely coming and there will be accounting, there will be no escape. Maybe this will train oneself on khushu' as much as possible. And when reading some surah, but as a non-Arab, there's a difficulty because you have to, usually you are reading in Arabic. Try to read, just maybe adopt few surahs, you repeat them, which contain, like, for example, لَنْ أَعْطَنَكَ الْكَوْثَرُ قُلُوا اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ and so on. Try to memorize the translation and a bit of expansion, and try to, while reading the surah, try to remember the tafsir of it so that you get some benefit from the meaning of it, and connect that with that there will be akhirah and accounting. Maybe that will produce the khushu', which will affect that ultimately you become then in salah itself khashi', meaning pondering about akhirah and focusing on and they just the Quran said. The two men may be in the same saf, but between their prayers, like between sama and earth, because some is completely conscious about his salah, and yaqil, he is rationalizing. He's, of course, it's not like just a state of, like what a Sufi claims, state of being completely in a mystic elevation. No, it's a state of rational presence, understanding. As I'm saying, you have from your salah only what you have completely comprehended and rationalized, and understood to reason about it. Like for example, when you say Subhanallah Rabbi al-A'la, you remember Rabb al-A'la, the supreme, the high, al-Azim, the great, the grand, the nothing greater than him. Things like that, try to repeat that to yourself. Hopefully this will make you rationalize more of your salah. Even if it starts to be like a cold intellectual rationalization, but it will develop slowly into a spiritual interaction. I don't see another way. That's it.
Yes,
the Sufi have some instruction. If you read some of the books of the Sufi, like for example, some kind of say called Riyaza and certain dhikr and so on before Salah and so on, it may be helpful. Try some of these, because these are like remedies, like taking aspirin and paracetamol and so on. This based on experience. They have experienced that, for example, doing certain number of tasbih and trying to focus and count the numbers help even focusing the mind. So there are many things like helping to focus the mind, like counting the tasbih, using shabha, various techniques. See how you can develop that. But it's not easy, it's a struggle. It's a very messy and complex struggle. But slowly, bit by bit, you will be able, inshallah, to build some. Okay?
A second question, if you've got time. Can I have a second question, Rashid?
Yeah.
I mean, I've got more questions, but I'll put them in writing. Now, this is, I think the ayahs about Pharaoh and the Bani Israel.
Yeah.
How did Bani Israel get to the position that they were? Because they were the leading nation.
No, they were not there. No, by Israel.
If you look at history, like the Yaqub.
Yaqub. That was a man with 12 children or something like that. There was not, that's Bani Israel, just a small family. And they settled in Egypt and grow in the Egyptian, let us say, in the Egyptian crib. It was like a crib. The nation developed there in numbers and became a solid number, became almost like a nation. Then the persecution started when the pharaohs, I will discuss that in another opinion, but as I said, most likely they went there in the time where the north of Egypt at least was under control of kings who are invaded from Asia. And the pharaoh were forced down the south. After several centuries, they succeeded to reconquer the north and expel those invaders. And Bani Israel were regarded as associated with the invaders, as foreigners, as Asian, not African, not Egyptian, and the persecution started because their numbers became worrisome. And the only way was just to exterminate them slowly, bit by bit, while also benefiting from their working force. Then they were saved. And before that, it was just a small family. So the time in Egypt was, by Allah's design, necessary to grow them to a number in the protection of a protective environment of Egypt under those foreign kings for some centuries.
But so, Sheikh, Bani Israel, they're the children of Hazrat Yaqub, yeah?
Yeah, Yaqub, yeah, Yaqub, who is Israel? Israel is Yaqub, that's his title. So,
from history, we see Hazrat Yusuf was in the power of administration in the government.
Yeah, that's because of the story of Yusuf. We'll come to that, inshallah. But this is a singular situation for Yusuf, and he was a messenger to Egypt. That's it.
Yeah. But there was more. The third question and the final question, Ayah 48, Wattaku Yoma Lataji Nafsin and Nafsin Shia. This particular ayah, can you apply this to Brelvis? Because the Brelvis say, we've got this peer and that peer, and they will intercede for us and so forth on Yom al-Qiyamah. Can you apply that to them and say, look, no, they will not intercede with you. They will be worried about themselves.
Yeah, they're against everyone, not only Israel, but Brelvi, because these peers, first of all, intercession Yom al-Qiyamah will not be possible without Allah's permission.
Yeah.
The question would be to them and to anybody else, did you have a covenant by Allah that that he will accept the intercession? Or you are just fabricating and imagining things? Like we will come to Bani Israel when they say we will be touched only by the fire for a few number of days. Allah says to them, did you take a covenant by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so Allah will not break his covenant? Or you are just fabricating against Allah without knowledge? In reality here, nobody, if the peer told you that, then he's lying. Because no peer, if he claims something like that, means he's receiving the revelation. He's a prophet after the Prophet. What's his evidence that he's a prophet? It's impossible. Then Muhammad is, if he's a prophet, then Muhammad is a liar. And if Muhammad is a true prophet, then this man is lying if he claims he will intercede. So if he claimed he will intercede on your behalf, he is lying and he's not a peer, he's a shaitan. And if he did not claim, then why are you claiming that he will intercede on your behalf? You're just putting imaginary hopes. Not only Brewi, everyone in the world. Everyone in the world.
So this, if you apply this ayah, so you know, this section and the next section, next few sections, you start with Bani Israel.
This will annihilate all these mythical theories about intercession and so on.
Yes. So this section, Ya Bani Israel, you know, these sections, are these ayah specific to Bani Israel or are they like general?
No, general, because لا تجزي نفس عن نفس. No soul will compensate for a soul. No shafa'ah will be accepted. Another place of Quran, no shafa'ah without Allah's permission will be accepted. He allows shafa'ah.
Okay.
And the shafa'ah allowed for those who give shafa'ah, like the Prophet ﷺ, is just to give him an honor. It's just like to put them in a high rank in front of the creation. This is my messenger. I will give him now shafa'ah for certain people just to give him that honor. Actually, shafa'ah is not needed. It's just a way Allah gives the Prophet and the Prophet some standing and compensation for that what they suffered in dunya. That's it. And the shafa'ah itself is completely irrelevant because it's with Allah's permission. So he'll permit only for that he wants to forgive anyway. But he gives it as for example, when you give someone is in dire need and you give him a solid charity which takes him out of poverty. Allah is the one who gave him, but Allah made you the intermediary, so you have the benefit of that and you get, because you are a man of good deeds, Allah wants to give you standing. Allah could have done it through someone else, by this man stumbling on a bag of gold coins and becoming rich without you. But he did it through you to give you some standing. It's Allah who gave it actually. The same with the Shafa'ah. No, this is all based on mythical Hindu-like and idol-like understanding of Allah and the universe. Completely false and wrong understanding of Allah and the universe. It's not only Brelwi. I wouldn't focus on Brelwi. Everyone, the same you find in Christian, they find everywhere. They think some peers and some will do Shafa'ah for them in some sense or another. There's no evidence for that. And anyone claiming he do Shafa'ah without having brought the evidence before that, the irrefutable evidence that he's a prophet, must be a liar, must be a shaitan. And even the Prophet, he said, what is he? Every prophet has been given three supplications which will be responded to. I have two in dunya and reserved one to Shafa'ah. The Shafa'ah is for Allah to come and to start the, because the creation will be left alone in a dire state of confusion. And they will say, this situation has become so untenable, we want Allah to come and judge. Who can go and ask the Lord to come for the judgment so this miserable state of suspense will end? This is a shafa'a kubra. There may be shafa'a, like for example, let's say that whoever memorized the whole Quran, and obviously memorized the Quran in also in action as we read it and act accordingly, so he can deserve the word to be a Quran reader, otherwise he's a munafiq. Whoever that, he will have the right to do shafa'a for 10 people from his household. He will give him, that's for his honor. For example, small children who die before the age of responsibility, they will give in because their share in life has been cut short, although this may be for their own benefit, because this way they have no accounting, Yom Al-Qiyamah, but they will be compensated for a possible life they could have lived on earth by giving them shafa'a for their parents. That's the reason the Sudanese call the small children, they're given the title of shufa'a. Like for example, Urdu, they call them ma'soom, the innocent, the infallible, the ma'soom. That's the Urdu expression for small children. For the Sudanese, it's called shufa'a, shufa'a al-sighar, the small shufa'a, the small intercessors, meaning the kids. That's a substitute for the word kids and things like that. So even the shafa'a is just a facility given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for some people for their own giving them more standing. Like you give in dunya, because human being, like for example, if you for example do some good deed and so on, you may, with the head of state, may give you a medal or something like that. It's just give you some kind of to fulfill the need of yourself of being distinct and assert your existence. That's it. And humans are created so that they need this fulfillment. And part of the compensation and the reward of Allah Ta'ala is giving some people the power for shafa'a in their behalf, in behalf of either relatives or the people or the whole humanity, like the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And it's well defined and well, and whatever it is with the permission of Allah Ta'ala. By giving to Allah Ta'ala generally and permission at the moment, like for example, when the Prophet said, go for the shafa'a al-kubra, and then he go in sujood. After a long sujood and supplication, Allah Ta'ala, lift your head, ask, we will give you, intercede, we will accept your intercede. He has to say intercede, we'll give you. Although he's already told us in dunya it will be, but it must be said in Yawm al-Qiyamah also. Because the shafa'a will be with idhni. وَلَا تَنْفَعُ الشَّرَعَةَ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا لِمَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ. We'll come in Surah al-Shara' al-Kursi. Yeah? So don't use it only for Braille, which is to be like anti-Braille. This is also, you find it very often for some Jubandi, you find it by Shafi'i in Sham, find it in other like Christians, believe that some peers or some holy men can intercede. This is all misconception and misunderstanding. Unless there's irrefutable evidence from Allah and His Messenger in the scripture, because we don't have any messengers at the moment, the last one is gone. So we have to rely on that, what is scripture. And in such issues of aqidah, it should be really by tawatur. Just relying on a filthy hadith or even a correct hadith is not enough. Anyway, issue of shafa'a is said in the Quran clearly. And more will come when we come to Ayatul Kursi, when the shafa'a will be discussed also. Yeah, postponed until now, then inshallah. But for this, it is sufficient. This should be sufficient for today.